strong.
Check this out.
The whole scene I've been around all my life was predominantly minority. When I came across the ocean, it was the opposite. I was like, they like house music like that?
In just 3 years, the house music of Chicago was to win over dance floors from Manchester to Ibiza.
When you first heard this stuff, it was just blew your bollocks off.
While its combination with ecstasy was to transform British society.
It was the first time that people actually let themselves go.
At the time, it was a revolution. You knew things were going to change, and you know, music was going to change, everything was going to change.
This is the story of the music and people who created the Summer of Love.
It was life-changing. It was life-changing for those people on the dance floor. It was life-changing for me in the DJ box. And it was life-changing for the bouncers on the front door.
Check this out.
In 1985, house music existed in just one city, Chicago.
Everybody was DJs, so we needed something to catapult us into another category to make more money. And that became, just fragmented into making records at that time.
The DJs of Chicago had created a new dance music from the ashes of disco. In 1985, legendary producer Steve Silk Hurley created its first hit.
We pressed it up, it went through the roof.
Hurley took house to number 9 in the American dance charts. But he didn't get the chance to release his planned follow-up.
To date, my biggest record in the UK is Love Can't Turn Around. And it came together from, it's crazy, it came together from an idea Steve Silk Hurley had.
Farley was over at Jesse's place, and he said he had this idea. And so he couldn't execute that. When he knew that the three of us could.
I'm running Dwayne to do the solo, the piano stuff on there. We brought in Vince because Vince was like the lyricist on everything.
Now this is how it started. My dream's all brokenhearted because I want you. We'll never be the same because you play these silly games and yet I want you.
We didn't have a lead vocalist.
I had recently recorded a song with this guy, Daryl Pandy, a song called Climax that was on Ray Barney's Bright Star Records. This guy was a motherfucker of a singer, and I had heard somewhere that he had played the Cowardly Lion in the local performance of The Wiz.
And he's gay. So to us, it was like, we don't want to have anything to do with this guy, you know, because he's constantly telling us how he wants to try to get with us.
He had a big bellowing voice, and he was very churchy, and we thought that the kids were into that spiritual shit, man. Motherfuckers yelling and screaming on the records, you know. So we thought that he would go over like gangbusters in the club. So we brought this guy in and he sang the fuck out that tune.
Now this is how it started. My dreams all broken hearted, yet I want you, baby. We'll never be the same, cause you play those silly games, and yet I want you, girl.
Farley started playing the shit on the radio, and you know, copies started flying out the door.
Record goes on the radio, blows up, huge, selling numbers.
But Love Can't Turn Around divided the friends who had created it.
You just want everybody to keep calling your name, Farley, Farley, you know, so it got a little bit out of hand at that time.
Within 30 days, I'm in Rocky Jones' office, and he's cutting us a check for $20,000, $30,000. You know, and I'm sitting up thinking, I didn't expect anything out of this record, but I'm making money.
You know, you're working with your friends, and you think that, you know, I guess everybody do the right thing when somebody gets paid, you know, that everybody's sharing the wealth, but you come to find it, it's just not like that.
I never got a friggin' penny
I don't think even Daryl got the money that he should have gotten.
But it was the track that catapulted House into the UK. Went top 10 in August 1986.
I played it at Haven. I knew it was just going to tear the place up, and it did. And then I played it at the Mug Club, and it, likewise, same thing happened there.
When I first started going clubbing, all the best clubs were gay, you know, and we would go down there and not pretend to be gay, but certainly pretend not to be shocked at everyone else in there, just to go and hear the best music.
DJs who played house in straight clubs in London got a less enthusiastic reaction.
Well, somebody else came up to me when I was partying in London with this kind of, you know, those kind of cloth rear groove caps they used to wear, and the steel toe cap, Doc Martens, and white socks, and 501s, and ME1 flying jacket. A look later developed by Bros, if I remember correctly. They said, well, I'll get this Puffs music off.
Then I started getting these notes passed to me saying, why are you playing this Chicago homo music?
I had a few kind of like things thrown at me, and I was called gay a lot as well.
Most of the clubbers were into rare groove and hip-hop, and you know, everyone was cool and down and that kind of stuff.
I think a lot of the hip-hop kids thought the music was quite faggy. they didn't get it, and in fact most people didn't get it.
No one's used to it. No one was used to that sort of tempo and energy. So you know, it took a while, but up north everyone was into it. Everyone were into it long before we were, as far as like, you know, going out and dancing to it and stuff.
Since the late 70s, soul fans in the north of England had held the torch for up-tempo dance music.
Bum, 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 I'm on my way, you know, and shit like that. You know, we grew up in a real Northern Soul sort of thing.
When House arrived in the 80s, it fitted into the Northern Soul all-night dance culture.
I think there was a lot of similarities. It was like, you know, very soulful, four-to-the-floor, fast music.
When the Hacienda started playing records from Detroit and Chicago, it wasn't that different, maybe, to what DJs had done a generation before.
I mean, when we first started the Friday night at the house, we got quite a lot of the old Northern boys coming down. When I was playing, like, Adonis, No Way Back, I mean, I could see lots of people doing Northern soul dances. Too far gone,
ain't no way back. Opened by Factory Records in 1982, the Hacienda was modelled on New York clubs, like the Danceteria.
It was empty for the first 5 years, completely empty. And then at the beginning of 86, it began to do some business. Friday nights were quite cool, not massive business. And that was where I always used to say Pickering and Park used to play house music in 86. In fact, it was Pickering Park and John De Silva, who I never give enough credit because his name doesn't begin with P.
I think Manchester was the epicentre of the whole house scene as such. I mean, there was things happening in London, but I mean, I moved to Manchester. Apart from the fact that I was around here, it was mainly, really, just simply for the Hacienda. And, you know, if you wanted to be a house DJ, it was the place to come.
But when you went in the Assy, you heard stuff that nobody else got for fucking months.
As more Chicago house trickled into the UK, DJs up north embraced this new black dance music from America.
You just had to clear out all the nonsense and make space for this exciting new stuff.
DJs in Manchester weren't just listening to house, they were making it. We'll be right back.
had the first British house single. That's the original sleeve, which we bagged ourselves from a little room in Islington in London. I remember that we didn't have any tape or anything to put it onto. We actually recorded it onto cassette and pressed it off the cassette. And it sounds fantastic, you know, it sounds really good. It's a lesson for us all who spend thousands of pounds in recording studios.
House music had crossed the Atlantic. In 1986, its Chicago Godfathers came on tour.
There was Frankie Knuckles, Marshall Jefferson, Fingers Inc. with Larry Heard, a genius, absolute genius, and Adonis.
Everybody was wearing ties and shirts, and you know, they were nice and neat, and the DJs, you know, they were back announcing every track, and it was great.
But of course, they got to Manchester, and there was queues, you know, the queues around the block, packed, and everyone just going mad. Everyone knew their records, treated them like superstars.
When I came back on another tour the next year, everybody's wearing these damn smiley T-shirts and going, So it's big change. And just in 1 year, you know, one year we come there, it's nice straight country, and the next year we come back, it's the summer of love. You know.
It's a great feeling, you know, that some people from Chicago had arrived in Manchester, and between us, we had a great scene.
They understood the music, and it was kind of like a common bond where people could come together, and just that feeling was more of an inspiration, you know, like, you know, people really need something, they really want to come together, you know, and walk hand in hand, you know.
Joe Smooth's experience on the DJ International tour inspired what was to become a house anthem.
When Joe Smooth hit the stage, it was, I can remember Joe's face as it was yesterday. He came on, I'm trying to remember the venue, we're up north, Huddersfield or something, and there had to be 3,000 people in front of him. And he walked on and it was like, boo, 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 and there's Joe Smooth in Promised Land, and he sang into the chorus and everyone knew the words. And here's someone who had just come out of Chicago. He couldn't get arrested with his record. It wasn't on any playlist, maybe two playlists out of 1,400 in the States, and here he is, and he's a household name, and girls are throwing themselves on stage.
The song itself is like taking the basic element from the Martin Luther King speech and just expounding upon it on a musical level.
Remember the same time as Joe Smooth. This is a great irony. The same week, the same month, the same day as Joe Smooth had the track Promised Land on the streets, the Style Council released a cover of Promised Land. Brothers, sisters, one day. If the Style Council hadn't released, we would have gone, without question, top five, maybe number one. But because, again, the might of the majors, they're buying this piss-poor imitation, you know, of a great classic.
I don't think there's another version that maybe would capture the emotion and the feeling behind the song the way the original version does.
We had the white artist adopting, almost hijacking a sound, because they knew it was the sound of tomorrow.
Ibiza played a huge part in the club culture that we know today. Really, because of the style of clubbing, really, I think that was brought back from Ibiza into London.
I'd only ever been in discos where you sit down and like sit in chewing gum, and it's all like, you know,
kind of all doom and gloom, and it was like this beautiful open air, like big Garden of Eden.
And you'd see a sunrise while you were still dancing, after having danced for like 6 to 8 hours, to this mix of music that you just wasn't hearing anywhere else.
Ibiza had been a playground for Europe's jet set since the 70s.
In the beginning, there was paradise, but man, foolish man, wanted more out of life. So he bit the apple to become wise. There he stood naked.
In 1987, four British holidaymakers were to have an experience that was to change clubbing forever.
September 87 was Paul Oakenfold's birthday and mine as well. And I think it was Paul's suggestion that we go to Ibiza for a week to celebrate the birthdays.
I had my birthday party there and invited Holloway, Ramblin and Johnny Walker.
Paul was running a little club in Streatham and plugging records. Johnny was working for London Records and Danny had just started DJing, you know, just doing a few little things here and there.
None of them were actually DJing in Ibiza at that point. It was very much a clubbing island run by Spanish DJs.
I remember a friend of ours, Trevor, going on about this club called Amnesia, and we'd heard about it, but it was always it's miles away. We'd have to get a cab there. Don't want to do that.
We got taken along there one night, and just amazed at what Alfredo was doing, you know, with the music.
There was kind of division between disco music and pop music, and we broke with that.
Enigmatic DJ Alfredo spun a Balearic mix of pop and dance music.
I had to make dance a bunch of people that were English, German, French, Spanish, old, young, all different circumstances.
What he was doing was playing right across the board, from rock to pop, disco to everything, every kind of music, and mixing it up.
So he had a mixed crowd there, and I think all he was trying to do was just, you know, play a mixture of quality dance music, you know, and still slip in some of the new things that he was into, which was Chicago house sound. We'd obviously also all been introduced into, like, you know, taking an E.
There was like sweat on their brow and their hairs was all like disheveled and they were like, what the fuck is going on here, you know?
I remember seeing Paul Oakenfold and I think Nicky Holloway skipping around the club hand in hand, which they might deny now.
I don't think that it was a necessity and I don't think that everybody was doing it. I just think E was something that brought the people together in as much as it made them appreciate the music.
As their holiday ended, the four friends resolved to bring their summer back to London. In the autumn of 1987, Danny Rampling recreated Ibiza in a gym in Southwark. He called it Shum.
Shum was just a sweatbox.
I don't know, it was just lunacy.
You know, the ceiling was like there.
You could barely see this far in front of you.
Danny Rampling was like there. Danny Rampling on the decks, and it's like, oh, it's Danny Rampling, it's Danny Rampling, it's Danny Rampling.
Now, some girl told me once afterwards that she could see his aura as he DJ'd. These people who, like, you were just like, it was like, oh my God, you know, they were in Gaultier suits one week, and next minute they were, like, very spiritual in. I'm one mateys, they say.
London was finally catching on to the joys of Chicago house.
unless you were on it, it was the difference between the lights being on or not off. I mean, you were in a fitness club, but as soon as you'd get sorted, you were in amnesia.
All these fresh-faced people, completely, you know, mashed on drugs, but because they hadn't been doing it for years, they looked quite healthy, really, and even the gurney looked quite attractive.
People were getting down there. They were taking loads of ecstasy. They were wearing loads of day glow clothing, and they were all going absolutely mad.
I hate to say it, but before Shum, the music didn't have an identity. You know, it didn't have a look. It didn't have a dance.
The whole culture of dance music and rave culture, you can say its beginnings were at Shum.
House had arrived, but the music was still being driven by America. In Chicago, producer Marshall Jefferson was about to create its very first supergroup.
Did a couple records under the name Ragtime, and when Atlantic Records approached us about doing recording for them, they said that they wanted us to record for them, but they hated the name Ragtime.
So he was looking for a group name, and I said, oh, intensity.
He said, oh, this stuff that we're doing, man, this stuff is so intense. I'm telling you, this is intense. I can feel the energy. That's my Marshall impersonation.
The way Byron was singing, you know, he would do extreme highs and lows.
I start messing around with the name Intensity, and I took the IN off of the front off of it and came up with Tin City, which I thought sounded a lot cooler. And then also I was sort of into numerology and things like that at the time, and I thought it was like, well, 10 is symbolic as the number of perfection.
Tin City, where everything is perfect, you know, and like, you know, that's where Byron took it, because he was like a deep guy like that.
Two people take a vow to be together and live and love each other forever. They promise to love a lifetime. Funny thing, then they change their minds.
Marshall, when he was producing those records, he was doing live strings, you know, he was doing
He was bringing out the
live bass and all that, and he was making them records. They were hot.
Sometimes he would do things in such a way, I guess it would be like Picasso. He would do things to me and it would sound like strange. I mean, just really bizarre. And so sometimes it wouldn't all come together until it was actually done. And you would go, oh, yeah.
No longer just about simple drum loops and raw samples, house was real music.
He hired 16 people to do hand claps. Yeah, he was like...
When he was doing the whole live thing?
He blew the whole budget on hand claps or something like that.
I just wanted all my samples to sound different, man. It's nothing special, you know.
In nearby Detroit, house was about to give birth to its angry sibling, techno.
We were focused in, man. We were like Shaolin monks or something when it came to music. You know, we were focused, we were locked in from the very before the beginning, I guess you could say.
Techno brought an intellectual theory to dance music.
Michael James comes to my house. He's a friend of mine from around the corner. He just wants to, wow, you got keyboards. I just want to sit down and make some music. Can I do that? Is it okay? Yeah, fine, go ahead. He starts to mess around with the piano. He plays piano wonderfully. And he's playing this ballad thing. He did it for, I don't know, hours, and I sequenced it for him, and he split. I just listened to it, and I heard one particular part out of it that sounded really interesting. So I just did an edit, and I just looped this one particular part of the sequence. And from there, I just went on to do strings. I was scared of strings. I was scared of that track when I did it. I was completely naked. in my house for a whole day, just walking around my house naked, looking out the window, you know, at this, at like this cityscape, and just listening to this track. I don't know, I was tripping. But I never did drugs, but I felt like I was on drugs, man. There was a guy in Chicago one time that said to me, he said, listen, he was in a record shop. He said, I don't know if I should dance to that or if I should waltz, you know. And that was the reason it was there for me, because I was trying to put, I was trying to show the sort of sophistication of dance music.
Strings of Life, classic.
Made by someone who had a vision of the future and a sense of what the machines could do if you allowed them to rock in this way.
Euphoric, yet futuristic, you know, yet Detroit techno.
It truly was a masterpiece. And you couldn't really categorise it either. It wasn't house, it wasn't techno, it was just Derek May.
I said, well, if you can imagine Kraftwerk and George Clinton stuck in an elevator with one keyboard between them, you know, and you got George on the left and you got Kraftwerk on the right. That was the concept, you know, as if they're stuck in this elevator for hours, and when it finally opens, you know, out comes this sort of, you know, funky metal smell, you know, and the keyboard is sort of flipped inside out, and, you know, that was it.
In the summer of 88, Big Fun thrust techno into the UK charts.
Paul Okafor was playing it at it was Monday night at Heaven. It was during the acid period, when the summer of acid, I don't know what they call it, but it was, you know, a good vibe. And then he played Big Fun, and it just was amazing.
Detroit's techno joined Chicago house in Britain as the soundtrack of what was to become the Summer of Love.
It was really about that time. And people would just sing it from the rafters. They would just be singing it from the top of their voices, but they have that driving techno sound to it.
Everyone was just living this lifestyle. It was so quick and changing every week.
It's just people gave up their jobs, they gave up their wives, their lives, they gave up everything. You couldn't go to work on a Tuesday morning, you know. You're better off outside the South African embassy singing Free Nelson Mandela.
I used to DJ at Spectrum till 4 in the morning, and I was still at the Casbah, you know, putting meters in the back of my car to go and fit them.
No one could stop it. You know, it was to do with us and what we were creating.
Only, I think, when Paul Okafor asked me to do Future, that I thought, well, I can't possibly stay up two nights a week and fit gas meters safely without killing someone, you know, blowing some poor old deer up. It was like an explosion of ideas, you know. People were writing poetry, you know, bricklayers coming in showing you bits of poetry.
Voodoo Ray was the soundtrack for 88 for Mancunians.
I was just picturing like some having like this big opening, like a, and then like bam.
It wasn't a song as such, it was just a groove.
Doom, doom. That's like, that's the killer part, really.
That old, that classic early house thing of a bloke just chanting something, which was Voodoo Ray, Voodoo Ray.
And you'd had a pill, and then there was this, you know, going over it, and then boing, 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 and oh, you know what I mean, and that was it.
Gerald Simpson's masterpiece was designed with one club in mind, the Hacienda.
Yeah, Gerald was hanging around the club, you know. We tried to get rid of him, but he just kept coming back.
Gerald Simpson used to come on Friday nights from early 80s, you know, like 84.
And he arrived at DJ Box, you know, at some point or other with a copy of Voodoo Ray.
I'm sure I just heard my tune, like a bit of it, and then, like, it came in. Oh, fucking hell, he's playing it. Oh, yeah, I can't believe it. And then, like, everyone started cheering. I was like, oh, shit, what's going on here, you know? So I ran upstairs to the DJ box. I was like, oh, cheers for playing it. I looked down, and everyone was, like, going off. I was like, wow, cool.
Now, the sound wasn't always fantastic in the house, because it was a concrete building. But, yeah, Voodoo Ray always sounded absolutely brilliant.
As Voodoo Ray dominated clubs throughout the UK, the Hacienda opened a new night.
Hots, I think the first night was July the 13th, 88.
And someone said, fuck me, man, go and check out your Wednesday nights. Stunning.
It was the sort of Ibiza thing. We had the swimming pool. Ludicrous idea. Can you imagine with all the glasses and, you know, people diving in and out? There was blood everywhere.
Some of the doormen were the lifeguards, and they had tables with the sun canopies on, you know, like you're outside in the sun. They were giving out ice pops when you walked in.
I walked through the door, 10:30, the next Wednesday night, and I look around in shock.
Like a you know, thundering train hit the Hacienda.
I remember one night standing in there and thinking, I really wouldn't rather be anywhere else in the whole world but standing right here, right now, in this place. Too strong. Check this out.
We had 2,500 people in there a night doing this and all going for it.
I came out of the DJ box, you know, several weeks into July, was just almost scared. It was exhilarating. It was just to feel the energy in the place.
There was a corner called E Corner, but to be frank with you, once Ecstasy set in at the Hacienda, the whole place was, you know.
You took the E, and because nobody at that time knew what it did to you, you didn't think you was doing anything wrong. You didn't think fucking six people in the corner all getting, you know, the dick sucked and sucking birds' tits was anything, you know, anything. It just seemed normal.
Enjoy this trip. Enjoy this trip. And it is a trip.
House was about to hit the high street.
Countdown is progressing.
The trip spawned 1,500 new ravers every week.
One time when I was there, we left the club and everybody was so high. You know, not high on drugs, just high on that whole night. We all poured out of the club.
You always say you'd have 1,500 people out on the street, not wanting to leave the buzz of the night. And of course, the road would get blocked. They'd be jumping in the fountains and the showers. And a couple of people would turn up and turn the music up in the cars. And before you know it, you had this massive street party going on.
I can believe that that's the power of what was going on.
Hundreds of Dayglow Acid Teds in central London didn't go unnoticed.
I think the big kind of sea change was a handful of clubs added to another handful of headlines in Sun equals pandemonium.
They helped make it get bigger.
You couldn't control it. Once it was out of the bag, it was out of the bag.
I'm sure that lots of people probably never heard about what was going on until they read about it in the daily newspapers and thought, oh, we'll have to have some of that.
So all of a sudden, everybody in the country wanted to get onto the kind of acid bandwagon.
As the tabloids fueled demand, acid parties exploded across the southeast.
These events were illegal. You couldn't actually give out the address.
Yeah, the looking for the party was probably the best bit for a lot of people.
You'd probably turn up at a kind of the corner of a street somewhere in Bethnal Green.
So they'd say, right, I can't tell you exactly where it's going to be, but take this mobile phone number, get ready, bring your driver, bring your people with you, whatever you need on that sort of night, and head off to this particular place.
And you'd go to the phone box in the M25, and then you'd get a number, and then you'd phone, and they'd tell you where it was happening.
Right, you've made it to the pub. Now get yourselves over to this certain, like, next village or something.
And you'd know you were getting there. The traffic was slowed down, you know? There'd be kind of gaggles of people hanging out of car windows, throwing bottles of Evian at each other.
Sort of pull up in our car with me in the back, the two dancers, the driver and his boyfriend. We'd say, oh, it's kinky, like we're playing tonight, we're doing that E-track.
And people were, like, traipsing one way or another, here and there, in the dark, you know, very unprotected from the elements, you know, without torches or anything necessarily. And they'd get there. And, you know, it was really like sunrise, you know, kind of like 10,000 kids going mad.
Anna S and a D coming in like love, sex and danger. Drop a tab of E and make your rub up with a stranger. Now bother vex your mind and feel say, Lord, it might derange you. Buck up on someone, love, make this fantasy go on, take you.
Everything starts with an E prompted a rapid reaction from Radio 1.
Radio 1 BBC banned it, and they said, you know, due to its lyrical content, and they said it was inciting the youth of today to consume drugs. My argument was, you know, it's a kind of social documentary commentary on the situation going on.
As Acid House took over the nation, the papers fueled a moral panic.
These young people, when they came to dance, didn't come with tents. They used to come just in their shirts and their slacks, and the young girls in almost nothing, and they would be laying all over these fields here. The music was deafening. We got Ferris wheels in the main field over there, and all the fairground attractions, plus the music. And over here, of course, is the cricket ground, where they parked the vehicles and created all that damage to the pitch itself. If I was to say that there was about 1,000 people in this village, which was swelled by at least another 20,000 between a Friday evening and a Sunday afternoon, one will get the idea and the perspective of a fairly sleepy, typical English village being turned into almost a dump with drugs, music that carried over 4 miles, people urinating on front lawns, worse than that, you'll get the picture how villagers felt, how the local parish council felt, and definitely how the greenkeeper of this lovely, lovely cricket ground must have been beside himself.
Throughout the summer of 88, every weekend another 10,000 kids lost it in fields beside the M25.
Most of the original people on the scene looked down their noses at that kind of stuff.
We used to sort of, you know, coat that scene off terribly, you know, it was all Judge Jules playing 15 gigs a night, and so nothing's changed.
I think it carried on the torch of just this kind of innocence and this kind of freedom of expression and not caring about, you know, the rules.
It was just a mass money-making thing, you know, controlled by villains.
Well, the first big party I ever played at, I saw, like, big bags of cash and drugs and sawn-off shotguns, but that was just over there, and it was more interesting what was going on over there with, like, 8,000 Dayglo people jumping up and down. So I went from, like, playing to 30 people to 8,000 within a couple of weeks. Some kid came up to me and said, you know, that track you played, well, the bass line changed my life. So I called one of my tracks The Bass Line Changed My Life. And I called another track Energy after that party. I wouldn't credit myself with innovations. I mean, I was just a cog in the wheel, really.
As the nation raved through another summer of love in 89, the police stepped up the pressure.
We were getting up to 246 parties in the region a week.
We'd have two of everything. We'd have two venues, two sound systems, two lighting crews, and if one didn't happen, we'd just go to another one. Simple as that.
I then had to resort to tactics that probably were not totally legal, but were somewhat effective.
The police were following us everywhere. They'd be following us, they'd be following all the people that worked for us, they'd be following the sound guys, they'd arrest the sound guys, the lighting guys.
Tomorrow could see the beginning of the end of acid house parties.
With the police seemingly powerless, in 1990, Tory MP Graham Bright entered the fray.
Graham Bright, the MP for Luton South, is bringing in a private members' bill which could result in organisers being jailed and their equipment seized.
But making the parties illegal only attracted more criminals.
I was kidnapped three times by three different groups. So, you know, I had shotguns in my mouth, and, you know, which was very, very, very scary. You know, on that particular occasion, I've got to admit, I cried my eyes out.
I think in a way we failed because we drove it underground. And when we drove it underground, there was far more dangers and there was far more thuggery and there was extortion.
We're only trying to do some parties, and that's what I would say to them. You know, we're only trying to do some parties, man. You know, it's no big deal.
I think there was a kind of unconscious reaction to the idea that Margaret Thatcher had propagated, that there is no society. And I think people created their own societies unwittingly in defiance of that statement.
It's great to see how it kind of broke down all social barriers and but racial barriers as well, in the sense of, you know, we wanted to dance to one kick drum and this is it, bang.
During that time, when we named ourselves, was when they used to be all those big London orbital raves where you'd drive around the sort of Potter's Bar service station ringing up a secret number and finding out where the next rave was. And they were sort of marching around the M25 towards us until one appeared about 2 miles away from our front door, which was crap, actually. It was a crap party. Absolute rubbish in a big cow tunnel.
Inspired by Chicago house, Detroit techno and the M25 rave scene, Orbital's Chime signalled Britain's total mastery of the new dance music.
Yeah, I can turn that on and off and that brings that sound in and out. These are MMT8s, these are what we use live. They're basically little hardware sequencers. They work in a system of each machine has 8 loops, 8 different pieces of music if you like, that they're all loops round in time, but then each machine has 100 of these groups of 8. This is all sort of going round. I might think, let's have some drums. And let's change the sequence at the same time. So I'll push that along. And there we are into another part of the song. You know, this is going round. It's a different pattern now. Hence the different tune. Might do something like this, put the bass line in, take the drums out. And then sort of prepare myself for something a bit bigger and bring all the drums back in. And there we go, Chime, in a live fashion.
So you pause place that on there, he's got the sampler playing that, and then I've got the mixing desk, and you can then you know, you can mess around with the sound.
Sort of played jazzy M, and his eyes nearly popped out of his head.
It was quite unique, and it was a unique sounding tune. It had all the kind of acidy twitterings in it, reverse strings. You know, Matt, it was just a great record, very, very original.
He was listening to it on headphones, and he was selling all these records on a Friday evening to all the DJs, and he said, look, I can't play it out loud, I've got to, you know, be selling people things. And he listened to it and went, hang on a minute, whipped his records off and played it, and just, like, stood there laughing. All these people going, oh, I'll have one of them. Oh, I'll have one of them. Oh, yeah, I'll have one of them. And all these DJs asking for it, saying, you can't have it, it's a tape.
The only way to actually cut that record was from that cassette, which I did.
But it actually came out slow, because I recorded it on my dad's tape deck, which actually ran slightly fast, so it's actually like a couple of BPM slower than it was supposed to be.
When we actually licensed it to FFRR, because Pete Tong went after it to sign it up, to save kind of face and embarrassment, we put the cassette onto a DAT, a digital audio tape, to actually then sell to him, so it wouldn't look too cheap.
That's the greatest example of how, you know, it all goes right from signing a 12-inch record that ends up being a 10-year career, and they're on their seventh album.
That was the actual Ozone logo there, and this is the only TP, as you can see, Chime 122, deeper the B-side.
Have you got some?
I've got one.
Yeah, I don't know, even know whether I've got one of these. They're worth 50 quid now. It's like, Jesus, I wish I had a packet full of those.
I don't think anyone's ever got close to them, you know.
And that Chime record was just so different, and to see those two guys standing on top of the pops doing absolutely initial, when all around was like Rick Astley or whatever was on at the time, I can't remember, and they were just standing there like, dun, 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 you know, it's just like brilliant, that was tops.
By the end of the 80s, the house music of America had effected a massive social and cultural revolution in Britain. Over the next 10 years, it was to show no sign of stopping. Come on.
The book Pump Up the Volume, price £9.99, and the official double CD History of House, featuring tracks from the show, are in the shops now. To order your copy, call 0870 1234 344 or click on to channel4.com/shop.